to you, we can hide in you. God, when we feel that we are nothing, God, your strength is made perfect in our weakness. And we just pour our praise to you. You say you inhabit the praises of your people, God. And we just speak your goodness. When you know nothing else to say in your trial, just speak the name of Jesus. Because like that last song said, it breaks every chain. There's resurrection power. It says in the Bible that the devil will flee at the name of Jesus. God, we thank you.
Let the King of my life be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my son. Let the King of my life be the shadow.
Never gonna let me down. You're never gonna.
Hey.
just wanna thank you, Lord.
As we're about to give this morning, I wanna challenge you for a second, because it's Christmas. Today is the day. Tomorrow is Christmas Eve. Christmas Day is Tuesday. It's right around the corner. And we give and we give and we give and we give. This is the giving season. But I want to sing that as right before we get our gifts ready. I want to sing that song that He blessed me once, He blessed me twice, because He has been blessing us our entire life. You just have to open your eyes and realize it. So I want to thank Him. I want to thank Him with our gifts that we're going to give in service. I want to thank Him for the people on Facebook who are watching who are going to give too. And so I want to sing that song one last time, that last verse, that He has been blessing us our whole lives before we give back to Him, because He is so worthy. A great kids video. The kids are excited down there, so we're gonna have the best day. I want to pray over the blessing, and I want to pray over our offering, and I want to pray over our day real quick. God, thank you. Thank you for who you are. Thank you, God, that you've blessed me not just once or twice, God, but my entire life. God, I thank you for the gift of your Son, who we celebrate this Christmas, God. We celebrate the gift of your Savior, God, born to us. Lord, you are so good. I pray that as we open gifts and spend time with our families, God, that we remember the reason for the season, God, that we remember who you are, how good you are, and how good we have it because of you. God, we can't give back to you enough, but I pray that as we give in obedience to you, God, it is blessed and it is honored in your name, God. We love you and we praise you. Amen.
A night like any other night, except for that angel. Ain't seen nothing like it before or since. Us shepherds, we don't get a lot of excitement out there in the pasture, but that angel, it was so bright, so beautiful. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, Sam, you've been out in that pasture just a little bit too long, and you'd be correct, but that all changed when that angel came right up to us. And the angel said, "Don't be afraid." I was like, "Too late." And then the angel said, no, I wrote it down. I need to get this right. Hold on. Okay. The angel said, milk, bread, no, that's my grocery list. Then the angel said, "I have good news of a great joy that shall be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." And then the angel said, "He's lying in a manger, wrapped in cloth. Go find him." Okie dokie. So we're all sitting around, and then one of the shepherds, I think it was Steve, he's like, "Hey, what are we doing? Let's get out of here. Let's go to Bethlehem." So we hightailed it out of there, and we found that beautiful baby I'll tell you, I was a different man after that. God chose me. And nobody's ever chosen me for anything. I'll never forget what that angel said, though. The angel said, I bring good news to all people. That means you too.
We are chosen by God. Amen. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Here at Go Church, we have not survived the season, but we have savored it. Can I get an amen in here today? Oh, man, God is good. I know everybody came to see me and not the kids play, so that's good. I feel so happy about that. We have had a wonderful time of just embracing the season and embracing life and embracing the goodness of God, and today I want to thank everybody for watching on Facebook Live and especially for the Hayes family being live in the house today. Let's give all those people a hand. It is awesome when we get to see one another and get to hang out and see what God is going to do. And this has been a season of just savoring and taking some time. I told you guys last week, we found out, remember the mic thing? Mics didn't work. The power on the board completely froze up. So last week I thought, these guys are crazy that are running the sound system. They weren't crazy. They are crazy. They weren't in the moment. And I was talking about last week, my dad, he always loved to enjoy and savor Christmas. It was one of those things that when he grew up, he didn't really have a Christmas. He kind of, I don't even know of just a handful of presents that he ever got. He was raised by a single mom, and she had multiple kids, and most of them were given away with the exception of him. And so his Christmases were, maybe he got, you know, to watch something on TV, or he got some candy, or he got something very small, or a pair of shoes that he needed. And so when he gave his heart to Christ and he started understanding the true meaning of Christmas and he started going to church, the one thing that he loved was the entire season, the holiday, not just the holiday season being all crammed into one, but the season to give thanks and to worship the Savior, Jesus. And one of the cool things, when we were growing up, we would have these presents, and it was crazy. When you're a kid, there are presents everywhere, and my mother would wrap everything. She would wrap the chapstick. It didn't matter if we had toothpaste, it was wrapped. Everything got wrapped. My mom would even open the package of pencils, and she would wrap them individually, so we took time to unwrap things. How many like unwrapping things? Say amen. When you get to be an adult, you get to unwrap something, it's like exciting. It's like, wow, this is so cool. It's like the kid in you comes out. And so what my dad was, he would love to savor it, but I'll never forget, and I pray I always do this with my kids, we take some time before the wrapping paper starts flying through the air. You take some time to just stop and think about why we're doing this. And my dad, we would get up on Christmas Eve. We were Christmas Evers. We would get up early, but it didn't mean we were going to open our gifts because we didn't do it until after our fancy dinner that night. And it was one of the few times of the year that I didn't care about eating. That was probably the only time of the year I didn't care about eating. I wanted to get to the gifts. And so we'd get up early, and we'd get up, and we'd get all excited and, you know, get showered and bathed. And we were like on our ultimate best behavior that maybe, just maybe, we would get to open the presents early. And that never worked. So we would get up, we'd get dressed, and we would go. My grandmother, literally from probably this building to the next corridor, we lived that close to one another. And we would get up and we would go across that little corridor or across the little pathway that we had made. In this empty lot out in the country, and we would go to Grandma's house. And that was round number one of gifts. I love when they come in rounds and in shifts, don't you? I like when it's an all-day unwrap fest is what I like. So we would go across there, and Grandma, her gifts weren't, like, exciting because, like, we lived in Eufaula, and the only toy store there was Ben Franklin. Does anybody know what a Ben Franklin is? Okay, yeah, thank you. If you do not know what a Ben Franklin is, do you know what an Ace Hardware is with toys, with a pharmacy? That's it, man. Wait, I got one. Who remembers Otasco? Come on, somebody in here. Oh, TGY was like Walmart for me. Are you kidding? Otasco, I'll never get. I could always tell the toys that came from Otasco. They had something to do with farming and gardening. Two things that I didn't know anything about. I'm like, oh, thanks for the tractor. That's cool. I want a G.I. Joe instead, though. I'll put missiles on the side of it. It'll be okay. It'll be a cool tractor. So we would start with round number one. Round number one, we'd open and it was always something. It was always cool. It was good. Those little miniature maple sugared people. Do you remember eating those as a kid? We'd get those, and they were usually left over from Thanksgiving. So I would get a Pilgrim. She would get a Mrs. Pilgrim, and then we'd get a turkey. And it was like, oh, awesome. I know these are on the bargain bin. Great. Thanks, Grandma. And then we get some socks. We get some nice socks that, you know, just plain black or white socks, no stripes on them, nothing. And I'm like, oh, awesome. And I'm like, oh, but I can't wait to get my toys, because I knew Mom and Dad had the toys. And so then we would go over to my Aunt Yvonne's house, and she'd say, hey, come over here. We got presents for you. Hers were almost always closed. Bummer. I was like, awesome, great. And so our Christmas Eve, we would go from house to house, and we would give gifts to them. And then we'd make our way back home, and it would be early afternoon. And I'm like, oh, God, we've been good all day. I've been thankful. I have been grateful. I have not complained about, you know, stale candy or old socks. I was thankful with the T-shirt that it was given to me, but I'm really ready to get into the toys, because I know there are toys under there, because I peeked earlier in the week, and I know that there are toys. I was a big bad. I could make such a minute. It's why I have to wear glasses today. I could make miniature minute holes in these toys and look, and I go, ah, yes, or in the wrapping. So finally, about mid to late afternoon, about 3 or 4 o'clock, they would tell us to go take yet another bath of the day and get all ready for Christmas. And now it was getting real. And we would go, we would get dressed, and sometimes we'd be in some brand new pajamas, because it was going to be an all-nighter, man. We were opening presents. Sometimes my sister and I, before my brother got into the world, and then we had another kid, and so we got less toys. That was the bummer about having a third kid. But, sorry, Benji. But we would sometimes rewrap them and then unwrap them again. You know, you ever do that? You're like, oh, it was awesome. Let's do it again. Yeah! And then the counting of presents and all of that, and who got more, and anyway. So about 3 or 4 o'clock, we'd get in the bath, and we'd get ready, and we'd put on our pajamas, and Mom and Dad would be in the kitchen cooking an amazing feast. It was the only time of the year, are you ready for this? We got peel and eat shrimp, the only time of the year. And we would have shrimp, and we would have cheese logs, the best cheese logs. We would have that little sausage that came from, not from just the grocery store, but came from the Hickory Farms. Smoked cheddar. We'd have little crackers. We'd have olives. We'd have all of these. I'm going to go on and on and on. Y'all are going to get hungry. We'd have cakes and pies, chocolate pies, cherry pies, pumpkin pies, pecan pies. We would have cobblers, peach, cherry, apple, whatever was floating around, we would have it. Banana cream pie, I love banana, coconut cream pie, we had that as well. We had ham, we had turkey, we had dressing, we had giblet gravy with all the giblets. Slice of egg thrown in there for good measure. It was everything. And my grandmother would come over. Just as it was starting, because we couldn't, I don't know why they believed that the Christmas magic didn't happen until the sun went down. I'm like, we could have done this about 8 to 10 hours ago, folks. But the sun would begin to go down about 5 o'clock, and we would sit around the table, antsy little kids that we were, and we would hold hands, and we would give grace, and we would pray. We would invite Jesus into our home. And my dad, every year, when we finished dinner, we would go into the little living room, and he would open the Bible, and he would read what I'm going to read to you today. And he would read the Word, and he said this every single Christmas, as long as I can remember. We'd be like, come on, come on, preach fast. class, Dad. Come on. And he would do this every year. He would say, kids, I want to make it last as long as it can. I want to make it last. I want to make it savor just as long as it can. So many times as adults, we just carry on life. We get up one day, down one day, turned inside out, upset, mad. And really what God wants us to do is savor every single moment that we have to cherish the love, the unfailing love and grace of Jesus Christ. No matter what you baggage you came in today, I'm going to tell you what, you can wrap that thing up and put it under a tree. But some of that baggage that every single one of us carry, we need to give it to God as a gift to Him that we're not going to worry about it anymore. We're not going to carry it around anymore, but we're going to give God the greatest gift we can give Him is total control of our lives, our heart, our mind, our will, and our emotion. And as we do that and we surrender to Him, Jesus will show up in our homes and He will live not just 1 or 2 weeks out of the year, but He will live all the time. He'll be there when you wake up. He'll be there when you go to sleep, because Jesus is the reason, not just for the season, but He's the reason I live. He's the reason I testify. He's the reason I preach. He's the reason I get up in the morning to do Jesus' will in my life. Amen? When you get to the place that it is not about your will, your home, your dynasty, but it is about, God, what can I do for you today? How can I serve you? How can I worship you? I'm going to tell you what, you won't walk around with baggage, and no matter how deep the trials get, come June or July, you're going to know that God is with you because He's never left you and He's never forsaken you. Can I get an amen in here today? Hallelujah. That is the reason for the season. That is the reason we do. We don't have to live down depressed. We don't have to live with an emotional problem. We don't have to live with a habit in our life, but we can live free if we allow Him to come into our lives. And we would come and we would gather around a tree. It's funny how it always started off with one gift at a time. And we would go, okay, we're going to open one at a time and we're going to watch each other. And then pretty soon, y'all know what happened, don't you? I'd get over to the side, and I'd be going, that's good. Y'all take your time, folks. I'm going to go ahead and start unraveling. That's what I'm talking about. Yeah, I got Cobra Commander. Booyah. I'm ready. Destro, I got you. I got all the, I mean, I was a G.I. Joe junkie. They'd be over there taking their time, and then Amber would see me. She'd catch an eye. And it'd be like wildfire. That thing was blowing up. The tree was blowing up. There was paper going, toys going. And my dad would go, all right, hold on, whatever you do. Because he knew it was over, man. It was done. He's like, whatever you do. Back then, you had to put everything together. Can I get an amen? You didn't get a tank that you had 4,000 pieces, amen? He said, listen, you could almost see the fear in his eyes. He's like, y'all kids are going to eat me alive. I know if I make y'all stop. And it'd be like you just like two bulldogs ready to tear into this tree. And he'd say, hold on, guys. Just don't lose any pieces. Because he was horrible at putting stuff together. Whatever you do, don't lose any pieces. And I'm here to tell you, church, today, whatever you do, do not lose your peace with God. Whatever racket, whatever noise, whatever confusion the devil may throw at your life, don't let the noise distract you from the peace of God. Because today, He can take your shatteredness, He can take your brokenness, He can take your hurt, and He can put it together if we just simply give it to Him. Turn to Luke chapter number 2. In those days, there was a decree that went out from Caesar Augustus, that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when the governor of Syria. And when all to be registered, each to his own town, and Joseph also went up to Galilee from the town of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David, which he called Bethlehem, because he was of the house of the lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her first son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. There was no place. We know this story in a minute. We're going to see it. As Mary and Joseph went from town to town, or from house to house, from end to end, everybody was in town. They were having a big party. Some were celebrating. Some were like, oh, no, I don't want to do this. But everybody was there that could be there. Everybody was in this town. Everybody was partying. Everybody was having a good time. Everybody was celebrating. Everybody was making merry, making the best of what they had. Everybody was doing this. And Mary and Joseph came into town, but they had a problem. And the problem was that Mary was about to bust, and Mary was going to have a baby. Mary was about to give birth to the Savior of the world, and they knew it. Wow, you think you got stress at Christmas? Can you imagine carrying the Savior of the world and nowhere for him to be born? For one, you go, man, that's some really bad planning, Joseph. Why didn't you think about that better? I will never forget my mother went into labor at church with my brother. She's like, I think it's happening. What? You're not due for a month. All my kids come early. I know this one is too. And sure enough, boom. So Mary and Joseph, they're going from town to town, or from house to house, and they're knocking on doors, and there was no place. There was no place. What in your life, whether you're here or you're watching right now, what in your life do you say there's no place for Jesus in that spot? Do you have an area of your life that you go, no, that I'm going to fix one day. That I'm going to make that better. I'm going to do this. I'm strong. I can do this. I'm a man, or I'm a woman of God. I can do this. And that particular day, Mary and Joseph, they were really at a point where they had no choice. And you may have been at a point where you really needed God to do something because your back was against the wall. And you know, Joseph had to just, please, can you do anything? Is there anything at all you can do? We've traveled so far. Mary's so tired. She's so sick, but she's got this weight of the world and this responsibility, and I don't know what to do. And all of a sudden, an innkeeper said, there's a place in the back. That's all I've got. That's the best I can do. There's a place, and it's a manger. It's really just nothing more than a barn. And what I find amazing about this story is there was this barn that they went into where animals lived. And these animals were there, and they were mooing and baying and crying, and all of a sudden this couple come walking in the room, and they walk into this barn, and this is it. God really wants you to know this morning. He wants somebody to know this morning. All he really wants is you. He doesn't want a big production. He doesn't want a big fiasco. All he wants is you. At the end of the day, what does God really want? He wants you and all the mess that comes with you. He wants you and all the dysfunction that comes with you. And the Bible says that Jesus was born in a manger. And in verse number 8, the same region, there were shepherds out in the fields, and they were keeping watch over their flock by night, and the angel of the Lord appeared to them, and they said, the glory of the Lord shone all around them. And they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, fear not, for I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes lying in a manger. And suddenly there was angels. There were multitudes of angels in the heavens. And they begin to praise God, singing glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased. And the angels went away from them into heaven. And the shepherds said to one another, let us go over to Bethlehem and see the thing that has happened. I started looking about the shepherds and why the shepherds. You know, why the shepherds? Many people have different theories, and I have one that I want to share with you today. I think about this. Mary and Joseph were running in town, and they were knocking on doors, and they were worried about where Jesus was going to be. And the ironic thing was Jesus was in a barn. And a shepherd back in the day, are you ready for this? A shepherd, many and most shepherds were homeless. The funny thing, Jesus was introduced to the world with people that didn't even have a home. Because they lived with their sheep. It wasn't practical. They would find shelter. And sometimes they would find mangers to sleep in. And I thought of this. Our Savior was born in a manger. The angel came down to the shepherds. What if, how cool it would have been, one of those shepherds go, I know that inn. That's where I lay up sometimes to sleep. That's the place that I go when, hey, I'm not working. The innkeeper lets me hang out in there. They've got some nice hay. It's great. No one bothers me. Jesus is there. He's crying. He's a baby. He's being born. And of all the people in the entire town, the rejoicing, the celebration, the same inn that they were rejected to enter in, not one person came out from that inn to receive Jesus Christ. Are we so busy? Are we so caught up with everything that we have going on that we can't stop for a moment of our life and just give and surrender what we have to Him? Let me tell you what, I don't want to be the kind of Christian that when Jesus steps up, when Jesus begins to move, when Jesus begins to talk, when Jesus begins to speak, that I'm so caught up in my problem, I'm so caught up in my celebration. I want to be the kind of person that says, Jesus, come and take over my heart. Come take over my life. Come be the center of everything that I have. You can dwell in here, because you know what? Our Father in heaven did not forget about those shepherds that didn't have a home, but He said, you are the people that I want to bring in the Jesus to this world. I want you people to go out and testify. I don't care. Today, you may be in a place where you're in high wealth or you're in low valley. Jesus came to save you, to give you a place, to give you room in His kingdom, because He loves and He cares for every one of us. In our celebrating, is there room for Christ? And all of our celebrating, I'm going to tell you what. God has never asked of me that He won't do more in return. God will never ask of you that He won't do more. God will never ask you to give, never ask you to serve, of which He'll give nothing in return. Because He loves us and He cares for us. Those shepherds out on the field may not have had a home on this earth, but they had a kingdom in heaven. They had a place to live in eternity, because I don't know why, but God saw in them something that would love to tell the story. Jesus wants you today to tell the story and follow the star. Follow the light, follow the hope, follow your dreams, follow into 2019 what God would have for you, and that is your absolute best life. God will never leave you, and He will never forsake you if we will just give God our hearts and our lives to total surrender. Amen? Every head bowed, every eye closed. Father, we thank You for this day, and we thank You for the opportunity we have to just surrender our life. And God, if there is one person in this room that has never accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior, we ask You today that we just take a moment and we say, Jesus, we surrender all. Jesus, we love You and we care for You. God, may this season be a season of celebration and not a survival. But now may we go from savoring the moment, and may we now celebrate the birth. God, we love You and we give You our heart, we give You our lives. And if one of you in this room today, you say you've never accepted Jesus as your Savior, I want you to know this. All you have to do is just say, Jesus, come into my life. Take away my sin. Take away my pain. I accept You as my Savior. And in a moment, Jesus is here to do exactly that, to give you all the peace you could imagine. Father, I thank You today to be with every single person in here. May You bring and may You reconcile families and lives. And we give You the praise and the glory. And the church said, amen. God bless you.
There was this girl named Mary. She loved God and she loved to clean stuff up.
But one day, an angel appeared.
Mary was so surprised
and kind of scared.
But the angel said, don't be scared, you're going to have a baby.
And then Mary said, how can I have a baby? I'm not married.
But the angel said,
it's all right.
The baby will be God's son, Jesus.
Mary was supposed to marry a guy named Joseph.
She said to him, "Look, I'm gonna have a baby."
Joseph was pretty surprised too,
because he didn't know how he could be a dad.
But he wanted to take good care of the mom and the baby.
Right before the baby was going to be born,
Joseph and Mary had to go on a long trip
to a town called Bethlehem.
But it was okay,
because Joseph made sure that Mary didn't have to walk by herself.
But when they got to Bethlehem,
it was so full of people.
Nobody had roof on them.
They tried one place.
Are you gonna get other place?
At the last place, the guy started to say no.
Then he said, "Wait, I've got a place for you out back."
But you gotta be okay with animals.
There weren't even any beds.
But it was nice and warm.
When Mary had Jesus,
they wrapped him in cloth
and put them in the animal's food dish.
No one else knew about Jesus yet.
But there were some shepherds just outside of town.
And some angels showed up.
The shepherds were like, "Oh no, what's happening?"
But the angel said, "Don't be scared.
I have something really, really awesome to tell you.
God's son Jesus has been born.
He's in Bethlehem. He's all wrapped up in a blanket."
The shepherds were super excited.
So they got everyone together and ran to find Jesus.
They were really glad when they found the right place.
They were like, "Is this where Jesus is?" And Mary let them come in.
And they even got to hold and cuddle the baby.
Sometime later, some kings were living far away from baby Jesus.
But God sent them a special star.
The kings followed the special star a long way.
A really long way.
A really, really long way.
The star showed the kings right where Mary and Joseph and baby Jesus were.
They even brought special presents for baby Jesus.
Then everybody had a big party,
because they were so glad that God sent baby Jesus.
That night was the best night ever.
It was the best night ever.
It was the best night ever!
It was the best night ever.
Nature sing, heaven and nature sing.
They got a little stage fright because when they were down there, I could hear them from here. They were so good. Did you guys get scared? Are all these people scary? They're just your family. Don't worry. You guys did so good. Can we give them a hand clap again? They're so good. We love our kids. They did great in their video. You did great just now. You hold that microphone. I think they muted me on accident. They should have muted you.
Hi.
Anyway, so tomorrow night, guys, it's Christmas Eve at 5 o'clock. So come back here, Christmas Eve at 5 o'clock. And then I'm handing over the microphone to Miss Paula.
These guys worked Hello. Really, really hard. And then they did get stage fright. You should have heard them singing in there, but their little beautiful faces were still here, so I told them they shouldn't be nervous. I want to ask, I don't know where you want to.
Yeah, we're going to ask Pastor Chad and Helen and Pastor Edie to come up here. No, yeah, this is a good thing. So, we're giving them a Christmas gift from the church. So you guys have participated in this, and we're giving Helen her own. She's a pastor.
There you go.
So it's not a package deal. They each get their own, and they do a lot of sacrificing for the church. All three, especially Chad and Helen, they put the church first above their own personal finances many, many times, and we appreciate that. And still, if you want to give them personal cards and gifts, that's fine. But if you...
Kenny Chesney tickets are still available. Thank you.
But if you really want to bless them throughout the year next year, if you're not a tither, consider doing that. Take your paycheck, move that decimal over, and give that to the church, and you'll be surprised the blessings God can give you from that. And that'll bless their heart, knowing that you fully support their ministry. When that comes in. Do you have anything to say? Okay.
Awesome. You guys, I want to thank our board and our leaders in this church. They are the absolute best. How long have we been together? For 100 years now. And they were crazy enough to go, hey, you want to put a resume in there? And I'm like, hey, do you want to think about this again real quick? But we've had a blast here for, 14 years now? We've been here out on the river for 4 years, I think, and we've had a blast. You guys, stand up on your feet, and we're going to get you guys out of here tomorrow night. Honest to God, if you can come out, it's going to be a beautiful candlelight communion service. Come out at 5 o'clock. It's going to be absolutely incredible. And the sermon has to do 100% with Kenny Chesney, and I'm not even kidding you. He is my inspiration. Those of you that is your first time here, I'm obsessed with Kenny Chesney. So this is going to be a great, we will be showing this video again at the end of service tomorrow. But I just want to pray for you, bless you. You guys did so good. Now you know why we shoot videos with no lines. That's why. I did great at shooting that. Aaron helped me with that as well. And Edie helped coordinate and direct all of that. You guys were awesome, absolutely awesome. Y'all, you have a great Merry Christmas. Father, we thank you today for every single child, every single volunteer who has served this year. This has been truly the greatest year in Go Church, and I ask you to bless our Christmases. Savor the season and celebrate it. You are dismissed. See you tomorrow night. Amen.